Welcome to this presentation on performance of microservice frameworks on different JVMs. I have a lot of ground to cover, so if you have any questions, please save them until the end. I save a couple of minutes to ask questions, to go into a bit more detail. There's also an article about the same topic on the last pages of the current edition of Java Magazine, which contains the graphs if you want to look at them in a bit more detail. I currently work for the Central Judicial Collection Agency, but I'll introduce it in a bit. First, I'll start with a short introduction. Who am I? Where do I work? Moving on to different microservice frameworks. I've compared 10 of them and created a minimal implementation of a microservice in all those frameworks. I'm also looking at different JVMs. Comparing them, I have a lot of graphs and results, which I want to show you. And I'll end with some recommendations based on those results. So this is me. I work for a company called Amy's, part of Conclusion, located in Nieuwegein. I present a lot, also internationally. I blog a lot. I like to share knowledge. I'm an Oracle acknowledged community expert, but that doesn't mean I have any content-wise obligations towards Oracle. So I'm not going to tell you that Oracle JDK is a great JDK, but you'll see from the results that it doesn't do that bad. I work for the Central Judicial Collection Agency, part of the Ministry of Security and Justice in the Netherlands, Dutch government. Most people in the Netherlands know this company from the traffic fines, but there's a lot more which it does. It also works together within the EU to make sure that, for example, if you drive too hard in Germany, you still get your fine in the Netherlands. It's important. They're located in the north of the Netherlands. It's one of the largest, there's a really large IT department. Some figures. Well, as you can see, what the CGIB mostly does is traffic fines, but they also play a part in, for example, suppose you're a victim of a crime and the perpetrator needs to pay you, then you don't have to go to the perpetrator yourself. CGIB takes care of the collection. And also for other parts of the government, they execute the process of collecting money. They are also involved with debt problems, community services, getting coordination of getting people in jails, those kind of things. So they do quite a lot more than just the traffic fines. CGIB does a lot with Java. They have a large IT department, more than 300 people, 30 teams developing using Scrum and SAFe. SAFe is a scalable agile framework. They have a quite well-developed continuous delivery setup, which makes it quite easy to deploy. They run on Red Hat, use JDK 8. Currently, they're moving to 12, to 11. And they also have an innovation lab, which does most of the really innovative stuff, the interesting things, the new technologies research. So I'll start with a small disclaimer. Well, it's a bit large disclaimer, but actually what this presentation is meant to do is inspire you. There are many things which influence performance. You can have different hardware, you can have different versions of JVMs, you can have different vendors, you can have different implementations, different database, different middleware. There are like many variables which influence performance. And I did some measures with specific code, conducting a specific test on specific hardware. It's all very specific. So if you want to know what a certain variable will mean for your performance, you should do your own test. And just let this presentation be an inspiration. Like, this is a knob I can twist, which might make it better. Or I haven't thought of this to try. This might improve my performance. So I looked at many microservice frameworks. This is a short list of the logos of different frameworks. And in all those frameworks, I created the same minimal implementation. to make it as comparable as possible, to compare the basic functionality just offering a REST microservice in those different frameworks. So what did I test? First, receiving an HTTP request, GET request, passing the request, routing towards a method. The method used a certain variable to create an object. That object is serialized and returned in JSON. So it's like the most minimal microservice you can do. You can imagine that, of course, if I would have made this any larger, then it would have been way too difficult to implement it in all those different frameworks, and I wouldn't have a case which would be easily comparable. So first, I also created a no-framework implementation using just Java SE code. Why did I do that? Well, to have a kind of baseline. This is like the most optimal performance you can get. Every framework adds a layer of abstraction. Every layer of abstraction is a translation, has a performance cost. So if I don't use any framework, like the most minimal implementation possible, I wanted to compare it to like what the minimal performance cost would be. And of course, this also, everyone knows what native compilation is, right? GraalVM is a JDK from Oracle. They provide a plugin, experimental plugin, which allows you to compile your jar files to native executables. Not every framework is suitable for that. No framework implementation doesn't use specific features which exclude it from the possibility to use native compilation on that. Spring Boot. As a Java developer, I cannot imagine that you don't know Spring Boot, right? It's really famous. Many people use it, many companies use it. Spring Boot makes it easy to use Spring. In essence, you can with like minimal effort create an application which runs production grade and one can run standalone. You can easily implement different servlet engines. It's opinionated, so they make a lot of choices for you, which make it quite easy to implement, but it's specific. Pivotal, which has recently been taken over by VMware, supports Spring Boot. There's Spring Boot also provides reactive flavor, Webflux. Webflux is non-blocking. So regular Spring Boot, you do a call and it waits, blocks a thread. Non-blocking means that it has the request and response split up. So in theory, you should be able to get higher, better performance at high concurrency using non-blocking frameworks. Of course, I wanted to know for sure. Spring Foo was quite interesting when I read about it. It's an incubator product. It's not suitable for production yet. It's not part of Spring yet, but it might become in the future. Spring Foo is Kotlin based. It allows you to functionally configure your Spring application, Spring Boot application. And it also allows you to compile natively because it does not use the dependency injection. Quarkus. How many of you have already had some experience with or heard about Quarkus? Quite a lot, luckily. Quarkus is relatively new. It's become popular in the past year. It's open source, supported by Red Hat IBM. Quarkus has some built-in functionality to interface with Kubernetes. Makes things easier. It has a lot of extensions to provide all kinds of different functionalities. Quarkus also can compile to native executables. Eclipse Vertex, Vertex supported by the Eclipse Foundation. It's unopinionated as compared to Spring Boot, which is opinionated. It's flexible. There's an implementation of Vertex in Quarkus, so you can, when using that implementation of Vertex, you can natively compile Vertex applications. Supported by Eclipse Foundation, of course. Akka. Akka is concurrent distributed resilient. It doesn't say performant. it uses the Actor. Uses an Actor framework to be able to provide functionality asynchronous. non-blocking, also supported by a company called Lightband. Micronaut has some interesting features. It not only allows you to natively compile your Micronaut code, but it also can wrap your Spring application with a part of Micronaut and run it as a Micronaut application, which allows it to natively compile. So this is quite cool, because Spring does not support the native compilation just yet. They will probably in the second or third quarter of 2020, but that's upcoming. It's supported by the Object Computing Group. Helidon, an Oracle microservice framework, has two flavors. There's a microprofile implementation and there's a microframework. The microframework allows you to functionally program your application. You can compare it to like Kofu, supported by Oracle. The microprofile implementation does not allow you to natively compile. I've looked at the microframework, the Helidon SA variant. Okay, microprofile. Probably there's been a lot of buzz around microprofile. It's a minimal set of standards which, when implemented, allow you to build microservices. There are many frameworks implementing microprofile standards. For example, Quarkus does implementation, Helidon does an implementation, but there are also some, well, more full-blown implementations like the ones listed here. I've chosen Open Liberty as an example to try and see what this does to performance. Okay, we have lots of frameworks, but we can also vary on JVMs. So I was curious, for example, if a specific framework like Helidon, would it do better on OpenJ9 than on Oracle JDK, or for example, those kind of things? Is there an optimal JVM for a specific framework? I wanted to be able to ask that question. Or are there general properties like this JVM is always faster than this, or are there differences in startup times, those kind of things? I wanted to be able to answer those questions. Of course, JVMs differ in a lot of things, and not only performance is a reason to choose a specific JVM. For example, support, like, is also a major thing. And the different JVMs provide different garbage collection algorithms. The different garbage collection algorithms also influence behavior a lot. So I looked at all possible garbage collection algorithms, which are quite a lot. Startup caching features differ, and there are also other features between the different JVMs which differ. For example, Azure Systems Zing provides some features which make application startup faster. OpenJ9 also provides features which make application startup faster, but only outside containers. In containers, it's a bit more difficult because you have a stateless container and you do not boot just the same application multiple times within the same container. So that's the difference between. But we'll get into that. What did I use to test? So we're slowly going to what have I actually done. These are the different versions of the frameworks which I used, and I tested it all on my laptop. You can imagine that when running a load generator and when running a microservice on the same laptop, they will compete for resources. So I needed to take measures in order to, as much as possible, separate resource usage. But I'll get into that. And for most of my tests, I use Docker. But first, I needed to confirm that the performance impact of using Docker was not too much. There's also something I'm going to show, a lot of graphs. I played a bit with the axis to emphasize the differences. So please be aware of that. The differences were mostly sub-microseconds because they were minimal tests. So what did I do? I did a lot with a lot of frameworks and tools. I first, for example, I created the minimal implementations of all the different frameworks. This was relatively easy to do because, well, when you know Java, you can go to Quick Start and take those examples. But then I needed to create a script to loop over all my different scenarios, to vary the JVM, to loop over the different fat jar files, to generate load. I first started creating a load generator in Node.js, but I found out that I couldn't control the event loop enough to be able to get accurate, reproducible results. So I switched to Python, which was much more stable in results. And eventually I switched to Apache Bench, which is a load testing tool, which is used by the Apache Foundation to test their HTTP server. It's quite a minimal tool. It's not suitable for complex functional testing, but in my case, perfect. I containerized it. There were also some challenges there because different JVMs provide Docker images out of the box, which is quite handy, but some of them don't, because there are limitations in the license which require you to accept something. Or so for some of the JVMs, I needed to create my own images. And of course, some visualization, mostly done using Python and later with Jupyter notebooks. So how did that look? Well, I had a bash script. I started out with bash. Wasn't a smart thing to do. I started out with bash scripts. It became eventually way too complicated to maintain. What did that bash script do? It created fat jars. It created Docker images with those fat jars with JVMs in it. It started also in a Docker image my load generators, which created results, but the results I saved every request on a separate line, so I was just testing the speed of my hard disk, which wasn't what I wanted to do. So I switched to first writing everything in memory, and only when I was done writing it to disk to avoid that. And then visualization. I removed the container part. The container, creating the container and dropping it, not only cost overhead, but eventually my tests. During the response time tests, I used 15-minute tests. I first started with 1 minute priming to warm up the JVM in the process. But I wanted to test many, many variables. So I got back to 20-second tests. And even with 20 seconds, when testing all these different variables, I couldn't use my laptop for over a week. It was calculating and processing requests and collecting results. So it would be nice if this would have been 15 minutes, but then I had to wait probably years or something. I'm not going to calculate it. Apache Bench for testing, Python for running the tests, because it was way easier to create my data structures beforehand in Python and loop over them than in Bash. And Jupyter for visualization. So my test setup became a lot easier. I used bare metal. The JVM was just running locally on my laptop. I didn't use any virtualization layers. The fat jars were running on the JVMs and Apache Bench for testing. Apache Bench also summarized my results, so I didn't have to manually do that afterwards. And because I had tested so many variables, I could also do interesting things like feature importance, but we'll get to that. I wanted to know which factor is most important for my performance, for my response times, for my throughput, for my startup time, those kind of things. So one of the challenges I already mentioned, resource isolation. I was running this on my laptop. The load generator was running on the same laptop as the microservice. So one of the things I split, I assigned specific cores to specific processes in order to avoid them competing for cores. That was one of the measures. Second one is I didn't write to disk because I didn't want to measure disk performance. I wanted to measure service response times. And especially with sub-microsecond differences, writing to the hard disk suddenly starts to matter. And I didn't use any virtualization layers. I started out with a Windows laptop, with a VirtualBox, with a Linux environment, with a Docker. You can imagine that it's almost impossible to get reproducible results. On Monday, I would get something else than on Tuesday. I didn't want that. I wanted to have results, which if I run it again. And even at the end of the presentation, there's a link with my test scripts. If you run them, and you run them again and again and again, they will provide similar results if your environment is stable and doesn't change between runs. Running in a container is challenging. I already mentioned some JVMs are available within containers, and some of them are not due to license restrictions and those kind of things. So I needed to create my own containers for that. And for Zing, there were also some challenges that you needed to map a device to your local machine and play with a license file. So, and Oracle JDK, similar. We'll start with graphs. This is an easy graph. The direction of the arrow is the direction of the messages. So this is the load generator. This is the service. As you can see, when the service is running in a Docker container, the performance is like this is response time. Higher is worse. The response time is a lot worse than when running locally. A lot. I did play a bit with the axis. I warned about that. So one of the reasons, I read some articles that Docker NAT, the network address translation which Docker does, has a performance overhead. And you can see that it actually does. I had hoped that if I would run my load generator also within a Docker container, the Docker daemon would be smart and avoid that Docker NATing thing. Apparently it didn't, because the performance was almost equal. This is the load generator running within a container. This is running it locally. Response times were very similar. When getting the service running outside, it came a lot faster. Application startup in containers was a lot worse. Why? Probably shared libraries. That's one of the reasons I can think of. And there were specific JVM features like caching. Zing and OpenJ9 have some caching features which allow subsequent startups to go faster. Those are quite difficult to implement in a container. Well, this is a graph with a lot of bars and a lot of information. So take some time to look at this. These are response times, 2 gigabytes of heap. I ran them for like 15 minutes on Java 8. Substrate VM are the natively compiled images. I couldn't natively compile every framework. I did for my no framework implementation for Helidon, Quarkus, and Micronaut. And one of the things you notice is that natively compiled services are slower in response times, slightly. They are slower. One of the reasons can be that the garbage collection algorithm, which is part of Substrate VM, is really basic. So it's not as complex as a full-blown JVM. And another reason can be that JVM, when it runs longer, it does some runtime optimizations, which are not possible when doing ahead of time compilation. OpenJ9 did like generally worse than the other JVMs with response times. Zing also, especially with these two, did slightly worse. Oracle JDK and OpenJDK perform almost exactly the same. So performance-wise, if you take one or the other, it doesn't matter. Didn't matter much in my tests. Also, three frameworks which gave the best response times were Vertex, Helidon, and Quarkus. I didn't only measure response times, I also measured throughput, I measured startup times, etc. And they do quite well in all of them. MicroProfile is open Liberty, as I mentioned. I had hoped that what my test did is I send a request, I waited for the response, I send a next request. So there's not much concurrency. Still, for example, Webflux did better than Spring Boot. Webflux is non-blocking, and Spring Boot, the regular Spring Boot, is blocking the request. But you cannot generally say that non-blocking frameworks perform better. At least not from these measures, because, for example, Akka is also non-blocking and did worse. I should quickly switch between these two graphs so you can slightly see the difference. Java 11 does slightly worse than Java 8. This is Java 11. Only very slightly. You can also notice there are no purple bars. Why? Because GraalVM does not support native compilation at the moment of writing for Java 11. I think it's coming quite quickly, or it's already available. I'm not sure. But at the moment of these tests, it was not yet available. Wait. You can also see that, for example, for Spring Boot and Akka, when running on OpenJ 9, going to Java 11 improves performance a lot. For the other JVMs, there was not much difference. So there is a specific case where upgrading to Java 11 improves performance. One thing to notice, though, is that I did use the Java 11 compiler to compile the same code as I was running on Java 8. But the dependencies are still Java 8. So that's one thing. And Java 11 provides some language features which might allow you to program things more efficient. So saying that like Java 11 is faster, is slower than Java 8 is, you cannot generally say something like that. Like, yeah, you can say it, but you cannot mean it. Well, this, I already summarized this, response times. Reactive frameworks do not perform, outperform non-reactive frameworks when looking at response times. So, however, OpenJ9, for example, when comparing 8 to 11, shows improvement. The other JVMs are all equal, or about equal, when moving from 8 to 11. So there's not much impact there. Okay, which JVM gives best response times? Well, this is a logo of GraalVM, but actually it's more like Substrate VM. It's the natively compiled plugin. There's a community edition of GraalVM is uses OpenJDK, so that's quite similar. So you compare those two. Zing and OpenJ9 did worst during the response time test. Startup. Quite interesting to see is that Helidon, Vertex and Quarkus again show best startup times. I did 2,000 startups, started the JVM and the application 2,000 times. These are arrow bars. The green one is 11, the rest are 8. But as you can see, there's not much difference between 8 and 11 in this case in startup time. But what was interesting to see is that OpenJ9 had quite a fast startup. I excluded Zing from these graphs. Why? Well, Zing has features to improve startup time, but I did not implement them and I saw way worse startup time. So I could probably have tweaked Zing to do better, but I decided not to spend too much time on that. this is outside the container. When you move inside the container, application startup for OpenJ9 becomes a lot worse. So the first time it's slower to start, after that it becomes faster. Native compilation, and also I didn't show native compilation. Native compilation is way faster than just-in-time compilation. The differences between frameworks also quite there. For example, Helidon does around 5 to 10 times faster than Open Liberty. Open Liberty is like an embedded application server, so you can imagine that's a bit more heavy than framework. Yeah, garbage collection algorithms. And I'm not going to talk in detail about each one of them, there are a lot. And also the differences, there are quite a lot of differences between the different JVMs. For example, Zing implements its own continuous concurrent compacting collector garbage collection algorithm. And OpenJ9 also has specific garbage collection algorithms. The Oracle JDK and OpenJDK are quite similar, only that Oracle JDK doesn't support some of the OpenJDK garbage collection algorithms. You can also see that the defaults change over time and that there are certain garbage collection algorithms which are only available in newer versions of Java. Well, what was interesting to see is that the garbage collection algorithm, especially when using plenty of memory, was not so important. More the vendor or the distributor of the JVM. For example, you can see that OpenJDK, all the garbage collection algorithms performed performed better than OpenJ9 and Zing. Zing did Yeah. So the choice of JVM vendor is more important than the choice of garbage collection algorithm within that vendor, for my case. OpenJDK serial garbage collection did best. What was interesting to see is this was at 2 gigabytes of heap. That's a lot for like a really small thingy. So I reduced that to 20 megabytes and see what happened. OpenJ9 suddenly became a lot better. I excluded Zing. Why? I said, well, Zing, here is your 20 megabytes, have fun with it. And Zing said, well, I rounded it to 1 gigabyte, okay? So Zing is only supported from 1 gigabyte and up. So it's not really suitable like for microservices. That's why I excluded it, because it was cheating. Also, some frameworks didn't even manage to boot, and certain garbage collection algorithms required more memory. For example, Shenandoah couldn't, with specific frameworks, couldn't even start with 20 megabytes. Well, when using other garbage collection algorithms, it could start. So memory usage of the different garbage collection algorithms also differ. Oh yeah, and the OpenJ9 metronome also many out of errors. So that's why I excluded it with this amount of memory. Okay, well, this is a complex slide, which is an entire presentation on a different conference. But what I did is I compared old garbage collection algorithms with 1, 4, and 8 concurrent requests for all the different suppliers, for Java 8, 11, 12, 13, for all the 10 frameworks, for 1, 4, and 8 CPUs assigned with three different kinds of memory. You can imagine that you get a lot of data, and I still haven't processed all the details yet. There's a nice classification algorithm, a random forest. What does that do? By the way, are you people a bit familiar with machine learning algorithms? Ah, nice. So classification algorithm, you can train it, and it will learn how to classify a certain input based on the data you already have. That's basically it. And with a random forest, you create many decision trees based on many different variables which you have measured. And you can use that for regression. It's, of course, not a continuous line regression. It's more like binning, because yeah, it's still classification. But it does a majority default and eventually gives a nice regression result. But so you can do predictions, which is nice. But I didn't use this model for predictions. One of the things you can use it for is to determine feature importance. How much did a certain feature contribute to making a specific classification? And why did I do that? Well, I have all these variables. What's most important in determining my performance? That was the question I wanted to answer. And of course, it's only within the range of variables I tested. I could have tested more, but already this small set took a week. So I did this for response times and for throughput. And framework choice, by way, is very much the most important factor in determining the performance in my case. So if I switched, for example, from Akka to Vertex, became a lot better. But if I changed that same microservice from Akka running on OpenJ9 to Oracle JDK, for example, it would improve much less. What was also interesting is that the throughput was not so much influenced by concurrency. So you would expect throughput, number of requests processed within a certain amount of time. You would expect that if I, for example, do 4 simultaneous requests with 4 CPUs, it would process 4 times as much as 1 CPU, 1 concurrent request, for example. That did not appear the case. Memories was not so much important during my specific case, so performance was not much impacted. During response times, the garbage collection algorithm was quite relevant, became less relevant with throughput. And yeah, assigned hardware was less relevant than software, generally speaking. So most improvements can be gained from looking at your software implementation, looking at your framework, looking at your JVM, instead of just putting in more CPUs and more memory. So it was nice to be able to get such a clear conclusion. Also, same for response times and throughput. So, of course, I already gave the disclaimer, right? This presentation is for inspirational purposes. So you know which things you can alter, where you can play with to improve your performance. But based on the measures I did, would I want to increase the performance of my specific code or my specific hardware? These recommendations are valid. So fastest frameworks with startup time, response time, and throughput with those three, Quarkus, Vertex, and Helidon. And these also have the additional benefit that you can natively compile all three of them, which is nice. By the way, a good use case for native compilation is, of course, your cloud environment, because your natively compiled code takes less memory, less disk space, and is quicker to start. And usually in a cloud, in a serverless environment, in a cloud environment, you pay for resource usage. So less resources, less money. So it's lower memory. I noticed that OpenJ 9 got a lot better when you reduced memory. So if you want to tweak, want to reduce the memory to an absolute minimum, OpenJ 9 is really interesting to look at. Docker containers, of course, Docker containers are really nice to use, and it has quite some benefits. But if you want like raw performance, you can consider running it outside of a Docker container. Because startup is slower, Docker not is overhead. And you cannot use specific caching features of the different JVMs. Java 8, Java 11. Java 11 at slower startup, slightly slower response times. Java 11, not yet at the moment, but it will come soon, supported by GraphVM to give you native compilation. So if you want optimal performance at the moment, I would recommend like stick with Java 8 for the same code. But if you want to move forward and use the new language features, of course, move to Java 11. And in a while, Java 11 will also allow native compilation. And the differences are slight. They are like sub-millisecond. Native images are interesting to use. You can run them in your serverless frameworks like Knative and FN Project, and you can also natively compile to Microsoft executables and run them as Azure functions. But that's even more experimental than creating native images on Linux. So it's about a bit of Russian roulette if your native compilation works on Windows. Some laptops it does, some laptops it doesn't. So I did a workshop once and about half of them failed. It was a bit mean. but I was working for the Central Judicial Collection Agency. So what did they do with these results? Well, they did not complain much about performance. So why fix something which is not really an issue? So if you can gain sub-millisecond improvements, is it worth investing in? So for example, is it worth switching from Spring Boot to Quarkus, which is really expensive to do, to rebuild your entire application for maybe small improvements? They use the Jetty servlet engine to run their Spring Boot applications. Jetty does quite well if you compare the different servlet engines. I didn't look at that in much detail. I looked at other data people managed to create. They're running on OpenJDK 8, as I already mentioned, on Red Hat. Well, Red Hat is currently the steward, was it called? The steward of OpenJDK. So patches, security patches, fixes, etc. Come quite quickly to at least to Red Hat. Spring Boot runs well on OpenJDK. Also interesting to notice is that every framework ran on every JDK, so I didn't encounter any specific compatibility issues. So you can try the different things, unless you're, of course, running, for example, a WebLogic server which is only supported on Oracle JDK, for example. Then you need to stick with a specific JDK, but for the different frameworks, I didn't find any issues. Garbage collection, they stick to the default as long as there's no issue. So all the code I written, I've added it to GitHub repository. My different flavors of the performance test. So I first started in Bash. Next, I moved to Python. They do have some requirements. For example, if you want to test on the different JVMs outside of Docker containers, you need to first install those JVMs and alter the script to point to the specific JVMs. Also, the Jupyter notebooks are available there, so you can pass the output. One of the things I noticed, which was really nice of the like Java community and the people working on the frameworks, is that when I started twittering and about results and publishing blogs, people got in touch. So the Oswald Systems people said, well, maybe you can do this and this and this to make it better. The OpenJ9 people said, well, maybe you can do this and this. And the Open Liberty people said, well, maybe if you like remove this and this and your jar becomes smaller and it will start up faster. Well, it was really nice to get that involvement from the community. also, of course, it's in their own benefit because if a specific framework or JVM gets good results, then people might be tempted to use them. Also, I already mentioned it a couple of times, do your own tests. So every application is unique. A specific garbage collection algorithm might impact your application in a specific way, which is different from another application. When running in a production environment, for example, sometimes you have, for example, NUMA architecture, a non-uniform memory access architecture, and certain garbage collection algorithms can deal with that more efficiently than others. So the memory architecture can also influence your results. In production environments, you often see layers of virtualizations. Those virtualization layers, of course, impact your performance, and you can have over provisioning and challenges like that. so my recommendation is do your own tests. So, are there any questions?